You are a good hiker. Yeah, I'm just taking pictures. Hey dog, go on, go on, good girl, go on, go on, good girl, go on, that's a good girl, stay. Wait for dad.
They sure learned a gear lesson or two while they were out here. Outdoorsmen, wilderness dudes in the Nutnfancy project, I think you may like this tabletop review. This is going to be called the best wilderness axes, and for that matter, hatchets, in the world. In my opinion, that's what I'm going to put on the table right now. Now, before we get cooking with all the details and POU and all the fun stuff, I think this will be a fun review. Let me say this, there's two bits of good news and one bit of not so good news. Which do you want first? Bad news, heard ya. The bad news is this may be the only wilderness axe review I will ever do in TNP. I'm dead serious. I just have too much other subject matter I'm interested in, need to spend time, energy, and money on. That's the bad news. Yeah, I could be wrong, maybe something really cranks me, you know. Things change, but that's the way I see it now. The good news, though, I think outweighs it. The first I've kind of alluded to. What I'm putting on the table right now, in my opinion, are the best wilderness axes mankind has yet produced. First up, we're going to be talking about this brand. And I'll say it the Swedish way, I think. It's Grand Forst Brooks. Boom! Small Forest Axe. Grand Forst Brooks. And I might like alternate between the American pronunciation and the Swedish pronunciation. Wildlife hatchet. Oh, dude. I just love these. And there's a lot of reasons I love these axes and the hatchets. We'll talk about them as we go. But that's not all. Okay, the good news, we're showing the best the world can produce. We're going to talk about Wetterlings, or Wetterlings, American pronunciation. Here we go. Large hunter's axe. Oh. And yes, I do have some time on these tools, these woods tools, and that's mainly what we're going to concentrate on. The small hunter's axe coming out, Wetterlings. The small axe, and I could be a little bit off on these names. This one is model 2020. This is 1734. This is 420 on the Grand Forst Brooks, and 420, and this one is 415. In case you're wondering. So that's the first bit of good news. We're showing you the best the world has to offer, and the second part of that is I'm showing you a lot. I mean, we went out and we spent some money on these to represent, and honestly, for me to learn. I'm always learning in the project. I'm always adapting my methodologies if it makes sense. I've talked to, and let's just jump right into it. Why don't we? Philosophy of use. I have talked a lot about the large blade survival knife. I'm still a fan. You'll never say anything that will convince me otherwise, so if you're gonna try to do so, yeah, don't waste your type and time, dude. Go invest your energies somewhere else, something more productive. What I have said is this, though. In a man-portable system where SAWC is critical, usually the axe, the hatchet, gets left behind in my backpack. That's what I've said. But keep in mind where I'm going and where I've gone. You know, 7 miles in the backcountry, and I'm not getting any younger. You know, I'm not Superman. I have had llamas to carry my load out, and on that, actually, I think I did have an axe with me. You know, on llama track. That was kind of cool. You know, if I have a pack animal or a way to carry it, a motorized transport, outstanding. Yeah, they're coming along. But if I'm really SAWC limited, I've always said, for weight, maybe they're not. Okay, so I'm not going to go too much more on that. I've spent airtime on that back in 08, 09. It's played. But when I can fit it into my system, when you get an axe of this quality, I'm going to look for an excuse to bring it along because how capable it is. And we're really going to focus a lot on the quality of Grand Schwartz Brooks and Vetterlings and how they put it together. And these are very similar brands. It's kind of like, this is like Acura and this is like Honda. They're both really excellent, but they're slightly different. I think you can't go wrong with either brand. The qualities are similar. And there's been some other crappy axes I've used that I've hated and that we bought also, and I haven't even reviewed them because they're so bad. Kind of like this one, this so-called etched Damascus Condor. I took it out on one outing and the head came loose. The steel is awful. The grind is awful. It's not sharp. I'm basically going to throw it in the garbage after this review. Not good. How about this one? The Snow and Healy Hudson Bay Axe. It's 2 pounds, 12 ounces. I thought we bought this one too for review. And I'm not going to say it's an awful axe. It's not. It's a good quality axe. It's got, you know, a long handle on it. It can do a lot of wilderness tasks well if you can port it in. Again, it's kind of heavy. It's got a hickory handle. I think the problem stems from the quality of steel. The forging process, the grind, and the edge, which is not great. It's a serviceable axe, don't get me wrong. These axes dominate it. There's no comparison. By the way, I think Snow and Healy is out of business. It's bye-bye. And it's a Chinese, again, head. I'm not going to say Chinese stuff is bad. I've brought tons of stuff to the table that's Chinese produced. It is simply superb in quality. We're talking about POU, though. These are focused woods tools, right? And let's look at this one, the Wildlife Hatchet. 24 ounces. It's number 415, 13 and a half inches. Look at this. Now that's an axe I'll make room for in my pack, if I can do it. I mean, there are so many tasks you can do with ease with these axes, and in this case, a small hatchet. So many. They're not everything, though, and let me cover that first. And this is from my own experience. If your experience is different, you have an opinion contrary, whatever, cool. But this is what I find. Splitting wood is not the forte of any of the tools on the table. In other words, I want a log split. I have a log that's 8 inches, 10 inches in diameter. Nice. To just split it with a tool like this, forget about it. Ain't gonna happen. You're gonna get the head stuck and it just won't work. Small logs like that, yeah. If they're dry, you can go through. You can split it. Did it. Now, you might remember, TNPers who've been here for a while, my, what was it called? Moonscape trek with Crockett, remember? Yeah, I brought along an axe. And I showed it heavily. I'll be rolling in the footage here. And I come up with the idea, well, if I need to split, I'm just going to make a wooden pawl, a wedge. And that's what I did. I split, and then I had a wedge, right? And then I used the pawl to just pound that wedge through the log, and I can split that way. But it took some, you know, some woodscraft, some thinking, and it worked great. I'm showing you on camera how well it worked. Is it my first choice to get through a log? It's really debatable. Survival knives aren't all that either. Every method has its... And I'm assuming that we need to get in the middle of the log, like I said a bazillion times, get to the dry wood. every situation has its, or not situation, but tool has its downsides. The downside to a large survival knife is, one, it takes a lot of work to use. It can break on you. They have broken on me. And chopping with it sucks because it transmits all the vibration to your arm, to your tendons, and I just don't do that anymore. The only time I've really done it is just to demonstrate what the knife can do, not what you should do. I've said that. But if I have to split in the choices between one of these tools and a large blade survival knife, and I'm talking something big like an Artac 2, I'll probably still go with an Artac 2 with some WD-40 and a freaking huge baton. Because I just have a span that, and it's a controllable split. It's just basically a wedge. It's going down the center of the log. I'm batoning. Comes right across. Usually. Sometimes it gets stuck and we have to get creative. But it usually works pretty good. These, they're small heads. They're really not designed that way, though, are they? They're not designed to be splitter. I mean, this one, and I reviewed this one years ago, this freaking splitting axe by Gerber. That's a medium quality axe. It's not that great. Steel on it sucks. But you can see a wedge shape on here. This is designed for splitting wood. You're going to have to get a, from these companies, they make dedicated wood splitting tools. And we'll get in the catalog and briefly show you. But these ones are kind of jack of all trades wilderness tools. They're designed to delimb. Let me get a veteran's out here. This is the small hunter's axe, 1734. They're designed to delimb, kindling, sometimes skinning game. Now, Grands Forge Brooks has a skinning axe that's pretty much designed for that. But it can do a lot of, when you choke up on it, like that, it can do a lot of the same tasks that you can do with a knife. I'm not the expert, but I can kind of figure it out there when I'm out there. And this is the only tool I have. You'll figure it out too. You're like, man, I can do this task you do with a knife. Building or constructing wilderness shelters, you can. I'll tell you though, cross-cutting with any of these tools on the table, I don't like doing. And I'm going to show you some video of me doing just that. I forget which one exactly I used. Probably the ones you see with the wear on. Both foot travel and also on the KTMs, going deep in the backcountry last year. And I just don't like it. It's high energy. It takes a lot of work. There's people who have done it that have cut their toes off because they screwed up because they're tired. They're not paying attention, which brings us to the safety factor of using an axe. Be careful. You know, look it up on the internet. There's all types of advice how to do it safely. If you don't do it safely, you could lose, I don't know, like I said, a toe. Maybe plant it right into your freaking shin. Not to say that large bladed survival knives, if they're misused, won't hurt you as well. They will. Like I said, everything has, you know, a certain level of competence that you'll have to employ it with. Welcome to all dangerous things. Jack of all trades, though. Splitting. Some carving you can do, and there's guys that are expert with these tools. I'm not. Yeah, it's a sharp axe. And they'll show you exactly how to use it, how to employ it. And some will prefer it way over a knife of any size or description. It's all personal preference. Not to say a knife won't do the same thing. They just like it. But that being said, it takes a huge amount of energy and time to do so. I'd much rather use a wilderness saw, like the Saw Viber. I did a review video on that several years ago. That's my preferred way in a backpacking situation to go across a log. Preferably, I have one of those big saws, Karen, that I've reviewed as well. Again, if I can take it. Jack of all trades. That's what it can do. And what I was really going to hit on is that it doesn't transmit shock to your arm when you do have to chop. Now, I think the catalog says these are designed to cross-cut, not cut with the grain. At least in the Brooks catalog, that's what it says. They have other axes if you want to go with that. And that kind of gets along with the splitting axe, the maul axes and stuff like that. But that's a big advantage. If I do have to cross cut, I save my arm. Another one is this. You're basically taking a big old hammer with you up into the woods. The paw. You can hammer in tent stakes. You can construct wilderness shelters with this part. Carving, hammering with that. You know, you can carve out wooden nails if you want to. There's guys who have constructed log cabins with nothing more than an axe. Are they crude? Yeah, but they work. And granted, they're probably specialty axes. And again, in some of these catalogs, they show just that. I love the hammering portion of it. And some of the big survival knives I brought to the table, they can hammer. They have like a, you know, a steel butt on the bottom, but it's kind of fraught with danger because I've been doing it out there, and then lo and behold, you're not paying attention. Your hand extends over the butt and you smack it and you got a big old blood blister, or worse. Delimbing, fire prep, some shelter construction, I think, are where the POU is going to concentrate on this. There is another philosophy of use that 5 years ago, if you were to told me this, I would have completely discounted it. And that is collectability of these axes on the table. I know, sounds crazy, right? Collectible axes? What? Well, it drives to the way these tools are produced in Sweden. It is ultra, ultra cool. It is so old world. They completely discount modern manufacturing, and they do it the way it was done 100 years ago. They forged the heads on these axes the way they did in the 1800s. Huge forges, heating the steel to 1200 degrees Celsius. I think this is C55 carbon steel. And no holds are barred on getting the finest grain, the best forging process possible. And look at how they grind it. This is a Veterlings. And again, this is the Honda. Let's look at the Brooks. And we'll show the big one here, the small forest axe. This is one we've put a lot of work on, too. Look at that beautiful edge. The shine indicates a fine polish, that there's a craftsman putting the edge on this that knows what he's doing. Now, they'll talk about in their catalogs that they don't really try to put a finish on here. They don't care. It's like, hey, dude, we love our work. We're showing you the forging process. We're not going to paint it. We're not going to put epoxy on it. We don't have to. It's old world. It is a beautiful work of art, so much so that each one will be stamped with the maker's initials. I don't know what AS is. This one, though, is MM, and this is a Brooks axe, and that stands for Matthias Mattsson. This right here. Isn't that cool? You know, how long have these guys been forging these axe heads and putting them together? A long time. You know, there's probably an apprenticeship that has to take place. It's so cool. Speaking of which, with the Brooks axes, you'll get this. The axe book. This is ultra cool. You know, when I buy something, I want something that comes with it that tells me about the item. That perhaps if I'm ignorant about its use, teaches me how to use it. This book does it. It's excellent. It talks about their approach, their philosophy. There's an axe smith right there, dude. Think he's proud of the work he does every day? Yeah. Look at that. Oh, there you go. There's the initials right there. I don't think AS is in there, though. Oh, there it is. Anders. I can't even say that last name. That's who built that one in the background there. So cool. Goes on and on. Talks about this. Mass production and rationalizations of production lowered the production costs. I highlighted it because it's so telling about their approach. And they don't do that. It's going back to old world craftsmanship, like I said. Teaches you the parts of the axe. The paw, the butt. There's the upper corner, also called toe of bit. Lower corner, heel of bit. If you ask me a year from now, I'd probably forget where that is. Of course, you know the handle, but in case you're wondering about the specifics, there it is. And then it goes into the models. I love this because then it says, hey, this is what this model can do as we see it. Talks about the wildlife hatchet. There's that skinny one I think I alluded to, the flay pole, to be used when skinning an animal. Stroke by stroke, the hide comes off, it says there. American felling axe. So this is a crosscut design. Big old axe, back in, you know, when they used to fell trees that way. Competition timber sports axe, a double-bladed one, small forest axe. That's one of my top recommended ones that I'm showing you. There's a splitting axe with that wedge-shaped head. That goes with the grain, able to do it. I would not backpack with that one. That's a cabin tool, a house tool, a plantation tool, you know, homesteading tool. Splitting maul. Talks about that. Carpenter's axe with its flat blade controllability. Good discussion here about how it carves better because of the flat blade. carving axe here. You can hew bowls out. Swedish broad axe. These are all Grenchforsch Brooks. There's that forging machine, dudes. Look at that, how cool that is. Collectability. Because you're getting a piece of old world craftsmanship, and how often do you get it like this from Europe? There's some knives I brought to the table that are amazing. That they do provide this old world craftsmanship. Look at this picture, I just love that one. Got an anvil there, the axe head's here, he's forging in the fire. That excites me when I see that. It's like, heck yeah, that is cool. Forging the head. So perfect. Like the pictures they've included. So this is the axe book, and it goes on and on. Talks about how you use it, employment of it, some techniques. You know, you can learn on your own. This will get you a good start. And then it talks about, at the end, you're caring for it, sharpening it, using, and that's, in that instance, a stone, round storm, both fine and coarse. I was going to show you about the guarantee, 20-year guarantee on the Grenchforsch Brooks. Collectible, dude. Now, here's the Veterans catalog, and it's the Honda version. It's a little bit thinner. There's not as much content. It's still cool. It gives the same vibe. I love it. And I think these are competing companies, not the same company. It's cool. It doesn't give you quite the detail and information the Axe Book does. I mean, I would probably first go for a Grenchforsch Brooks if you could. And then if you can't, I wouldn't hesitate a second going with a Veterlings, from what I know. Yeah, collectability philosophy of use because of the quality levels. Phenomenal. These, by the way, are American hickory handles, specially fitted, tightly fitted. And we had no problems with them at all, coming loose. They do acknowledge that modern materials like fiberglass is stronger, but they're kind of environmentally aware and they don't like using anything that's not natural. And I think it's a good decision because these are traditional woods tools produced in traditional ways with amazing capabilities. Why ruin it with a fiberglass handle? There's other axes out there you can have. That, I mean, freaking Gerber has it. Are you going to get this quality? I doubt it. How about weight, balance, and feel? I'll say this, every axe on this table has a perfect balance for its intended use. This one here, again, this is a Grenchforsch Brooks small forest axe, and I write this on the bottom here so I can remember. It's 37 ounces, that is 2 pounds, 5 ounces, 20 inches overall. Great swing. This is actually my favorite size right here. You may be surprised. You may be thinking, well, you'd like the small ones, right? Nope. These are more capable. And for what they can do, they're not that heavy. In the axe world, we're not talking the knife world here, we've gone to the axe world, they're pretty light for axes. Carryable in a pack, depending how far you're going, how much other stuff you're carrying. The Wildlife Hatchet, 24 ounces, 13 half inches, I've covered that one already. Then we go to this bigger Veterlings. And notice, by the way, when I got these, I ordered these from a company that's now out of business in 2010, Wiseman Trading Company, it's long gone. I would probably recommend you go to another one I found called amtraders.com. Tell them TNP sent you. I have no idea who they are. They seem to have fair prices, and they seem to have a good selection of some of these axes. You can look around too. But notice the rust. And most of them came this way on the Veterlings, and I actually had to take some of it off, and then finally I just gave up. I was like, yeah, whatever. I'll just oil it up as I have done this one, and that's how it goes. I don't think the Grenchforsch Brooks came with rust on them. I really don't think a tool should arrive to the owner with rust. I think it's because the company, Wiseman Trading, was back east and it was a humid location, and these are carbon steel blades, are going to rust. But this, again, is the same size, right? These two axes are pretty identical. This is a large hunter's axe for the Veterlings, and I just love the way it swings. I like its authority. And when we're talking about axes, that moment arm minimizes work. Now, the little hatchet right here, if we're chopping, cross-cutting with this, you're going to be working a lot because your moment arm's very small. Granted, you have a nice, approximately 1 pound head on it. That'll minimize some of it, but get a longer handle if your system can take it. 2 pounds, 2 ounces, this one. This one is almost identical, 2 pounds, 1 ounce. And this is 1734 Veterlings. Veterlings, small hunter's axe. I would go with this one, and did. because it's essentially the same weight, why would I go with a shorter handle? And finally, the Vetterling small axe. This is a beautiful little woods tool. Don't get me wrong, it's very capable for its size and weight. 25 ounces, model 2020. What a good looking axe, dude. This one didn't come rusted. And the thing I love about this small hatchet is you have a hammer with you. That is so functional. If you're building wilderness traps, you know how handy these axes are. Little hatchets, you can pound in your stakes, your triggers, carve your triggers with those. Amazing. The steel seemed like it held an edge very well. Imagine that, after being forged so carefully. Sharpening the axes, I think, is a little bit of a pain. You'll see guys in the comments go, oh, it's not a problem at all. Well, I think it's a problem if you want to achieve what it achieved coming out of factory. See, that's the issue there. So if you go, oh, it's easy. Well, to produce the edge, I mean, these things are razor sharp. And that is super key why they are so effective. And you'll see that in the video I'm showing you. These things cut like a knife. I never believe guys like, well, a hatchet doesn't have to be sharp to work. I disagree, especially after using these. I mean, if it's sharp, I mean, it minimizes work. You can get a precise cut. It rocks. You can keep them sharp. Again, you can go multiple stones. You can put a mouse pad with some emery paper on it. Roll it. You're just going to have to get a real consistent concave grind. You know, and just kind of feel it and see where it's at. I'd be careful about chipping them out, because if you chip them out, they're going to lose some effectiveness. Let me see if I've chipped this one. Yeah, I did a little bit right there in the use. Just a little chip there. I almost cried when that happened, by the way. The handle we talked about, moving on down the line, 20-year guarantee, at least for these ones. I'm not sure about the Vetterlings. The Wetterlings, let's see if it says right here. Don't say anything. They might have it. I don't know. Competitive options. I really don't think of any. It ain't this one. This is in a different league. Not Bush League, but it's in a different league. These are the freaking Ferraris of the axe world that I'm putting on the table. They are. There's some other great axes out there, but do they hold the same old world specialness? You go decide. I'm not sure. The ballpark value on these is going to be around $120. How's that? Oh, that's good. And the problem I have is after I get done with this video and they're reviewed, which ones do I sell? I have to sell some. I don't have room to store them. Go to the web store. You may see some of these come up for sale, and I'm going to cry because they're so cool. Even my boys think so. But I'll go out backpacking. I was like, well, let's go. And they're like, nah, I'm not going to go backpack with you. It's too much work. I was like, well, I'm going to sell those axes. Don't sell them. Those are too cool. Kind of like that. Kind of like that. Huge cool factor, man. Especially the Grangefors Brooks. I mean, with the freaking initials of the maker in the head. But either brand is just going to serve you so well. For collectability, highly recommended. For woods work, highly recommended. You have to decide if you can fit it into your man portable system. You're going on a snowmobile, sometimes a motorcycle. I will usually even go something lighter on a motorcycle. You know, carrying a 2-pound axe, that's a lot of weight on a freaking KTM 500. And if I dump the bike, every time I dump the bike, I have to lift that weight up. It weighs down the suspension. It's just a lot. I usually will carry, I don't know, kind of like a Cold Steel SRK. This one's a Samine 3. That's what I'll go with. Your mileage may vary. But beautiful tools, constructed totally through the old methodology. Highly recommended. That is the best currently that I know of the world has to offer. That's a Nutnfancy review. See ya.
That is a good looking axe, don't you think?
It is. You know what? That makes the axe I have completely and utterly worthless.
temperature gauge too.